As I said, we're going to use basically the guidelines as our plans of the evening, our agenda for the evening, and we'll just kind of follow right through them. I'm going to sort of take care of the first few bullet points on the list, and then we'll take a break. We'll reset so that Noah can get set up for his presentation on writing artist statements, effective artist statements, and then we'll leave lots of room at the end for Q&A. And hopefully this is, you know, our, between the two of us, our presentation is about maybe an hour, and then we'll, you know, we'll break for Q&A after that. So, as I say, this is kind of the general flow of the evening. So obviously that's the first page of your guidelines, right? And as you start to read through that, you're going to see some key phrases and some key words that really jump out at you and are things that you should really make note of.
Let me grab these for you.
So the first thing you'll see right at the top of the page, and I've highlighted some of the information that I want to really make sure that we talk about. Obviously, application deadline is very important. This year, the deadline is on March 13th. And so what that means when it says postmark by 11:59, if you intend to mail your application to us, as long as it's postmarked by, you know, 1 minute before midnight on the 13th, it's fine. A lot of people like to hand deliver their applications, which is fine as well. Our office is right upstairs. It's open until 5 p.m. on the 13th. So if you want to walk it up and say hi and have some coffee, whatever, just make sure that it's in our hands before we close up shop that day. So by, you know, by 5 o'clock. So whichever one of those you prefer. So that's, you know, that's pretty cut and dried, and pretty obvious. Under criteria, we're going to spend a little time on this because it's important. You'll see I have highlighted mid-career composers working in any musical genre. All right, so let's talk about mid-career first. McKnight really wants to award composers who have reached at least the mid-career point in their trajectory. And it's not a very clear term. You can define mid-career in a variety of ways. So the foundation has given us, the program is designed to award composer whose work is of exceptional artistic merit, who've created a substantial body of work over a period of time, and who are at a career stage that is beyond emerging. All right. So those are some key words that hopefully help you sort of zero in on whether, you know, where you are and if you fit the somebody else. If you fit that mid-career sort of model that McKnight is looking for. You know, we use the word emerging a lot at the Composers Forum. For those of you who are aware of the Jerome Foundation, we do a big program also for the Jerome Foundation every year. It's a commissioning program, and they're all about and only about emerging composers, folks right at the starting gate of a career. So people who have had very few commissions, very few performances, very few awards, honors, that kind of thing. People literally right at the threshold of launching their career. So that's who Jerome wants to focus on. McKnight's the other end of the spectrum, all right? They're saying, you know, the emerging composers are taken care of by Jerome. We really want to look at folks who are much more established, much farther along in their career. So that's an important question, you know, I think for you to ask yourself and answer for yourself if you're going to apply for this. It's a stipulation that McKnight makes, not the Composers Forum. But they want us to enforce that mid-career status and be rigorous about it. So that's one of the first things when we convene the panel and we start looking through the various applications. It's one of the first things we talk about. You know, is this applicant, in the panelist's mind, is someone at the mid-career stage? So that's a decision that they make. So they say that's an important designation that you need to keep in mind. Any musical genre is the second part of that sentence. And you know, the foundation is also really serious about rewarding creative excellence in a variety of genres. And I think if you really look back over the last 4 or 5 years of this program and look at the names of the composers who have received fellowships, You'll find a hip-hop composer, a number of jazz composers, electric acoustic composers, very traditional Western, classical concert composers. There's a real variety of folks who have won these fellowships. So we really are serious about saying, sort of the welcome mat is open to, any kind of style, and a very large spectrum of composers. So that's mid-career musical genre. And then, if you jump down to awards, I highlighted unrestricted funds. And that's also a key word that I want to talk about. Unrestricted means just that. McKnight, this is a reward for a job well done, in McKnight's view. It's not tied to a project. It's not tied to a recording you want to do, or traveling you want to do, or study, or a big piece that you might want to compose. McKnight doesn't really care how the money is spent. It is unrestricted. They do have one stipulation I'll talk about in a second. But really, this is an award for you to reward good work and to encourage you to do more. A lot of applicants will take up space in their artist statement to say, during this year, I want to write an opera, I want to do all these kinds of things. They put in budgets of how they're going to spend the money. McKnight doesn't care about any of that, and the panelists really don't care. You can do it if you wish, but that's not going to be a tipping point that pushes you over the threshold of getting a fellowship. It really is about the quality of work that you've created and the impact you've had on the arts in the state. So that's unrestricted. Oh, let's go back here for one second. I'm sorry. So it's a $25,000 award. It's paid in three installments. For those of you who are interested, you get $10,000 immediately, as soon as the announcement's made, and we do a little bit of paperwork. So there's $10,000 that comes right away. The next $10,000 comes about halfway through the fellowship year, which traditionally means in November. You have the option, if you'd like, to defer that payment until 2016, so it's in the next tax year. And you don't take that whole hit, $20,000 hit in 1 year. You can do that, and then we'll send you the check right away in early January. That's your decision to make. And then there's a final $5,000 payment at the end of the fellowship year, which would be pretty much a year from this May. And that comes with submission of a report that says, here's what I did during the fellowship year. You also get a couple of other wonderful perks. One of these is brand new to the program. McKnight Foundation talked to a lot of past fellows and said, in addition to the money, what would have really made the year special? And everybody said we wanted time to just concentrate on our work and give away. And so I was able to negotiate with 5 artist retreat centers across the country, literally from California all the way to Connecticut, that agreed to completely waive the application process for McKnight Fellows and automatically accept you. Based on the fact that the fellows have already gone through a really strenuous panel process by top professionals in the country. So the idea is that you have, during the fellowship year, to sort of research the 5 sites, determine which one feels like the best fit for where you'd like to be. And then you have up to 4 years to do the residency. So you don't have to just uproot yourself in the fellowship year and do that. You can tell me this is the one I want to go to, and I want to go, in the fall of 2017. So I negotiate that with the site, and McKnight pays all the expenses for that, including they give you an additional $500 to help cover transportation costs and other kinds of things. So it's an amazing gift, and the 5 sites are phenomenal. I get very jealous every time I have to work and line them up for other people. There are other wonderful perks as well. You get free memberships to the Walker Arts Center for the year and a number of other arts organizations. You get 8 hours of sort of one-on-one counseling time with Noah or the staff at Springboard for the Arts, which can really be valuable in all kinds of areas that you might need, from financial planning to marketing to all kinds of things. Getting the fellowship is kind of the gift that keeps on giving. it's a really wonderful thing, and we love McKnight for it. Now, Eligibility is, you'll see a section there. Really the mid-career composer is the main and the main thing, and we've already talked about that, so I'm not going to dwell on that again. There is a stipulation that in order to apply, you have had to have lived in the state of Minnesota for a year prior to the application deadline. So as long as you, you know, moved here prior to March 13th, 2014, you're fine, as long as you've lived in the state. And then the foundation really does ask, if you win one of the fellowships, that you live in the state for the duration of the fellowship year. You can travel, you can, you know, even do extensive travel, but they just want to make sure that your primary residence is in the state of Minnesota for a year following. So you can't take the $25,000 and use it as a down payment on a loft in Brooklyn or something. You know, you can second or third year, but that really is the only stipulation on how the money is spent from the McKnight Foundation. Way down at the bottom, this is a new guideline this year. It says, note, applicants who are ABD, which stands for all but dissertation, are not eligible to apply. And that's a new change in the guidelines this year. In the past, as long as you were done with all of your coursework, you could still be enrolled, you know, while you were working on your dissertation, your final project. It was fine. But this year, McKnight's saying, no, we want you to be completely through. You know, all of your education has to be behind you, and you really do have to be on that career path before you're eligible to apply. So we're trying to really make note of that, because as I say, that's a big change this year. A couple of other things. That second bullet point, there's a three-year waiting period after you've won a McKnight before you're eligible to apply again. And that's in any discipline that they award fellowships. And on the front page of the guidelines, you'll see there are nine different disciplines that McKnight awards fellowships in. And the one that's closest to us as composers is the performer fellowships that are administered by MacPhail. And you know, there are a lot of composers slash performers, performers slash composers. Sometimes folks will apply as a performer to MacPhail. Sometimes they might apply as a composer to us. That's fine, you just can't apply the same year to MacPhail as a performer and to the composer's forum as a composer. And likewise, if you win a fellowship this year from the composer's forum, you can't apply in any of the other disciplines for 3 years. Once the 3 years are done, then you're eligible to apply again. And we do have a number of folks who have won multiple fellowships during the course of the program, and that's fine as well. McKnight is fine with that. If you're one of those people and you're going to apply again, then what we ask you and McKnight asks you is that you really focus on the gist of your application on the work you have done since you won the last McKnight, the last fellowship. Nothing before. Just tell us what, you know, how your career has moved along since then. So we're going to step into sort of going through the application process and the application materials kind of step by step here. But before we do, I just wanted to just give you a couple of general hints for doing this process. Charlie? So the first one might seem, you know, like a no-brainer, read the guidelines. But something like McKnight, that's really important because, you know, we this is an annual program for us. A lot of you probably have applied numerous times. So you might think, well, I've done this in the past, I know the process, I'm just going to apply again. But as you just saw, the guidelines can change from year to year. So it's really important to spend, you know, 15, 20 minutes before you decide to apply and really read through the guidelines. And make sure that everything is still. Create a schedule or a calendar is the next bullet point. You know, I really think time is so important in this, and it can be your best friend or your worst enemy. And I really recommend that people start the application process about a month prior to the application deadline. and really give yourself the time to do this well, and build in some contingency time in case, you know, you get hit with the flu or, you know, some other emergency happens that, you know, takes away the time that you were going to devote to writing the application, and you have to spend it on doing something else. So give yourself that gift of time. I promise you it'll be a better application because of it, and your nervous system will thank you. So if you, you know, the opposite would be waking up on the morning of March 13th and saying, oh, I've got to write this today and get it in the mail and that kind of thing. That can be a pretty daunting task. I'm a big fan of asking family or friends to read my application and listen to my work samples, you know, and really give me feedback. You know, did I do a good job of saying what I wanted to say? Was I clear? Were they, you know, they getting the message that I wanted them to get? How did the work samples grab them? You know, that kind of thing. And if you do that sort of in the middle of your process, then you've got time to adapt, edit, you know, take their comments, that kind of thing. But it's, you know, I think that's really important. It's like proofreading your own work. Sometimes we're, you know, the worst proofreaders because we read over the same mistakes. Here, as I say, just get some fresh eyes and let them sort of react to what you've written. Test your work samples on several playback units. If you're submitting, you know, nowadays a lot of people just burn their own CDs and DVDs, and there's nothing worse than getting to the panel session, popping one into ACF's playback unit, and it doesn't play. So if you test it out in a couple of different systems, car, wherever, and really make sure that it's, you know, it's good to go before you send it, that saves some gray hair. Put yourself in the shoes of the panelist, and by that I mean when you're, you know, doing your page layout and typing everything up, you know, ask yourself if it's a font that is easy to read, it's easy on the eyes, that there's some white space on the page, that things are organized and laid out, and, you know, really carefully. This is one of two panel books from last year that the panelists got. We probably have about 100 fellowship applications last year, and then we also manage a visiting composer residency program for McKnight. There are about 30 applicants for that. So between the two, this is all of the written material for about half of the fellowship applicants. There's another book that the panelists got. So, you know, they read through a ton of stuff. And first impressions, I think, are really important. So, you know, there's some wonderful, you know, wonderful examples in here. But then there are also some where the type is so tiny that it's just really difficult to read, and it doesn't give a really good first impression. The other thing is, you know, we will photocopy and bind these into books. So making sure that you allow a nice left margin, so you don't lose what you've written to the binder process, you know, is really important. So we do these panel books for each of the panelists, and they're required to read through all of that material. So as I say, that's just kind of a common sense thing. And again, if you have peers looking at your work, they can react to say, you know, that's just too much information on the page. It's that typeface is really aggressive. You know, whatever. I think you can tone it down and make a better first impression. Contact the program manager, me, before and after the process. You know, my name and contact information is on the applications. I'm always happy to look over samples of your proposal and, you know, give you comments about it, answer any questions you have leading up to the application deadline. And then I can't stress enough how important it is to call after the announcements are made, and get feedback. Now, for all the programs that the Composers Forum manages, we literally sit, we have staff that sits in the panel sessions, and we transcribe their comments. And so you'll get to hear verbatim, well, generally verbatim, you know, what the panelists said about your applications. And that can be really, really helpful. As you start planning other applications that you might want to do. We do it anonymously. I don't say, Craig Carnahan said, you know, this about you, that kind of thing. But, as I say, it's just really valuable information. And so I think that's a really important part of all of this. So those are just some general hints. Now we're just going to walk through the actual step-by-step procedure of what constitutes an application. And it really is one of the easiest applications to do. We were talking about that before the meeting started. If you've ever applied to the State Arts Board for one of the Artist Initiative grants, you know, you have to supply a ton of information, a lot of demographic kinds of stuff, and a lot of information. For this, less is more. You know, we ask for very few things and only a couple of pages of material in each of the various categories. The first thing you see is just the cover sheet, which is very self-explanatory. It's, you know, it's literally the, gathers your contact information. And at the bottom of the sheet, there's a little checkbox so that you can make sure that you submitted everything that we asked for. What did I do? Yeah. We're going to skip over the next thing in your packets is the artist statement. But that's what Noah's going to talk about later in the evening, so we'll skip over that right now and pick that back up later. You're asked to submit either a resume or a bio, 2 pages maximum. Obviously, those are different formats. A resume looks much more like an outline. It's much more academic, and you really can organize material in an interesting way. So education, awards you've gotten, commissions you've gotten, performances, recordings, you know, whatever categories you want to sort of really highlight for the panelists. I think it's really easy to do in a resume format. And you only have 2 pages, and you can fill those up pretty quickly. So, as you'll see, I put like awards and honors, and then you'll see partial list. That's to let the panelists know this isn't all of it. I was selective. You know, there's, you know, more that I could have put there if I had the space. So I always start with the most, it's a chronological list in each case, the most recent award, the most recent commission, and then work backwards from that. So they want to see what's he doing right now, and what did he do 10 years ago, that kind of thing. So it's laid out chronologically. In the commission category, which is at the bottom, I hope you can see that, you'll see that I've listed, again, 2014 was the year I wrote this piece, the title, sonnet, the performing forces, in this case, men's ensemble with piano and oboe. It's 6 minutes long, and the Reveille Men's Chorus of Tucson commissioned it. That's all information the panelists, it's really helpful for the panelists to know. They want to know how long are the pieces, how much music did you write, how long are these pieces, is this a symphony, you know, or is this a short song, you know, that kind of thing. And who did you write it for, and what are the performing forces? It's really important information to include for them. If you want to do a bio, obviously that's, sort of reads like an article and is much more narrative in structure. If I had my druthers or my choice, I would always do the resume, because I think it's just really easier to call out and just really let the panelists know exactly what information you want. If you're asked to supply a bio at any point, you know, you can still use bold type and italics type and all kinds of different things, again, to sort of highlight titles and names and pieces of information that you want to call out to the panelists. But you can submit, as I say, either format is fine, 2 pages maximum. Work samples. And these are extremely important for McKnight. I'm guessing that about 95% of the decision comes down to work samples. We allow you to submit 3 recordings and 3 scores, if you use scores as part of your composition process. The first track of the recording, we ask be no longer than 4 minutes. It doesn't have to be 4 minutes. If you have a 3-minute song that you really think really introduces your music well to the panelists, you can put that on. You can make it a 4-minute excerpt of a larger work. Some people even put 2 or 3 snippets of their music together into a little medley in that 4 minutes, which is fine. It's just that 4 minutes is your way to introduce you and your music to the panelists. And a couple of things to follow up. If you are going to make it a 4-minute excerpt from a larger work, then I really strongly suggest you include the larger work, the complete larger work, as your second or third sample. Because panelists are going to say, wow, I love those 4 minutes, you know, but can this composer sustain this level of interest, you know, and quality over 20 minutes or whatever? Or is this the, you know, the best 4 minutes of, you know, of the piece? Similarly, if you were going to do sort of a little medley of two or three examples, I wouldn't do more than three. It gets confusing if, you know, if there are more short things in a 4 minute in a time frame. So I would limit that to maybe three max. And the thing, and this always makes me nervous to have to say, but because ultimately it's absolutely your decision on what music you submit and how you want to present yourself as a composer. It's not up to me to, you know, to dictate that. Mm-hmm. But what I'll say is, from my experience working with panelists, if that's that 4 minutes that you lead with, make it something that grabs their attention immediately. You know, and again, just remember, they're going to be listening to work samples from 100, you know, 100 composers. So if you've got a piece that really starts very slowly and very quietly and takes 4 minutes, you know, to sort of evolve and grow, and then bam, something happens, I would really recommend you cut to the bam and really grab them right away. And, you know, engage them and say, wow, you know, this is somebody I really want to hear more of. And then, as I say, then you can make that full piece your second or third work sample, and they can hear, you know, a broader example of the music you write. But again, it's just keeping in context all the different stuff that they need to listen to. Scores, some people use scores, some people don't. You know, if you're somebody who works with jazz improv, chances are scores, you know, that's not part of your creative process, so you don't need to submit them. If you are going to submit scores, it really is great if they, if the scores correspond to the audio samples, you know, the audio tracks that you submit. If you don't work with scores, then explain to the panelists your role in the creative process of how that piece came to be. And really make it clear to them, you know, whether you gave them the performance lead sheets, whether you gave them sketches that they were playing from, I mean, like graphic sketches, if you sang ideas to them, you know, and they were mimicking, you know, whatever you need to do to say to the panelists, this was, you know, this is how I created this piece. Without that, and I've heard this said so many times, the panelists will say, I don't know if this is a really talented composer or if they've got the best Rolodex in the Twin Cities with the best performers, you know, and I'm hearing just really top-rate performers, but they don't know, you know, how you helped create the piece. So that's, you know, that's really important. And again, if you've received a fellowship before, your work samples should be limited to the period from when you last received the fellowship until now. The final thing I'm going to talk about is the work sample sheet. And a lot of people kind of look over this, but I think it's really a valuable tool. Again, you get such little amount of space to talk about who you are as a composer to the panelists. So use every inch you can and every opportunity to talk about this. So here, there are three work samples. And this, you know, this is how I would do a submission for myself. So track one has a corresponding score, the name of the piece as everyone sang. I let them know that this is the entire piece. All right. Oops, I just blew it, didn't I? Because it's 8 minutes long. I said it has to be only 4 minutes. So we'll pretend it's 4 minutes. So it's written for mixed chorus and piano. I wrote it in 2013. This is who it's most recently been performed by and who's performing it on the recording. And then I tell them why I decided to include that, because it demonstrates my ability to set text for chorus, which is a big part of the type of music that I write. Okay. Track two is an excerpt of a larger piece. So I let them know that. Again, I let them know the instrumentation when I composed it. And then if you look down in the bullet points, I think it lets them know that this excerpt begins approximately 10 and a half minutes into the piece, so it gives them that context of where this is within the 45 minutes. And then it tells them in the score, if they want to follow along the score, that this excerpt begins on page 55 at measure 210 and, you know, extends from that. So it just helps them walk through and find that information really quickly and efficiently. And then number three is a string quartet that I did, just as a totally different kind of example of something that, that doesn't have choral music on it. So as I say, I think the work sample sheet is something that's really important, and you can, that can also be up to 2 pages. And you can put little program notes, you can put whatever you wish, to really help introduce that piece to the panelists and help educate them why this is something that that you wanted to include. So other than now, the artist statement, that really is what you apply, what you use to apply for, or for one of the fellowships. So I think we'll take a little break. We need to change some computer stuff up here. And if you haven't picked up guidelines yet, I think most people have, they're up here on the table. But well, as I say, we'll take a little break, we'll get Noah set up, and then he'll do his presentation, and then, as I say, there'll be time for Q&A afterwards.
So as I'm getting this plugged in, I'll just do my quick introduction. Thank you for having me come in. My name is Noah Keesecker. I am the Director of Artist Development at Springboard for the Arts. Everyone familiar with Springboard for the Arts? This is a huge group, by the way, and it's very inspiring because I see some familiar faces, but I see a lot of unfamiliar faces, and I'm just like, oh my gosh, these are my people. Like, where are you? And you're like, where are you? Pointing fingers. And let's see, this should... Ta-da! See, this fast. And so my background, so what I do at Springboard for the McKnight program specifically, aside from do presentations for musicians and composers, anybody that basically wants me to come in and say, hey, I look at a lot of these things, here's some tips that I can provide that'll hopefully help you make a better application. I also provide, if you are awarded a fellowship, McKnight pays for up to 8 hours of consulting, one-on-one contact time. So I run that program, it's called the McKnight Fellowship Field Guide Program, and it's really exciting. I don't necessarily do all the consulting, I do handle a bulk of it, but there's 15 people at Springboard with tons of resources, so it's my job to sort of, be your field guide during that fellowship year. You actually get 18 months to use that those consulting time. So even though your fellowship year, for instance, ends after 12, technically, we realize that after you get $25,000 and a $10,000 check, coming to sit down and talk business plans and financial management with me for hours on end is probably not on the top of your list. So we let you sort of enjoy it for a bit and give you a window to say that this is not just 12 months, this is like 12 months and into the future, and how can Springboard support you? So that program is really cool if you're part of it. The nice thing about Craig's presentation that's different than the one I do for the musicians is that normally I talk about all the parts and not just the artist statement, so that should cut me short a little bit, which is great. But I'll just kind of work through this and jot things down for questions as we go along. By all means, hop in. So this is my famous slogan, which is, I love writing grants, it's so much more fun and easier than writing music. Said no musician ever. Okay. Which is to say, I think this is kind of what we're afraid of, right? I mean, if we're just really honest, you're like, I have to sit down and write a jargon-filled discourse on personal life journeys told through generic expressions and cliched imagery wrapped around pedantic technical exclamations and grandiose self-promotion. Yes. So, and I feel this way because, like I said, I'm also a composer, so I struggle with this too. I was telling Daniel beforehand that I still hate just about every artist statement I write for myself, but it is a necessary step. It is a necessary facet to helping a panel of strangers who probably don't know you from, an icicle outside, better understand you as a human. And so this is the thing we're trying to, in my presentation, I'm going to take the approach of, here is a structure and here are some categories for you to generate language. and fill that structure to sort of take the heart out of it, or the fear part out of it, and just stick to describing yourself in a very clear, concise, and concrete way that communicates well on paper to a stranger. So, with that, if you've ever been to a Springboard workshop or you've ever seen me talk to them before, you've probably seen this three-sentence artist statement. If you can boil everything you do down to these three sentences, then that to me is the kernel of all artist statements, whether it's a bio, whether it is a elevator speech, whether it's an autobiographical resume, or if it's an artist statement short or long. The thing you need to be working from is saying, who, red, that's terrifying. It's like very Dr. Seuss in here now. Who you are, what you do, and why you do it. Let me fix this. And so, for instance, in my example, I tell people, like, here's mine, which is, you know, not the end-all be-all, but it's the introduction. That I'm, you know, my name's Noah Keesecker. I'm a composer and multimedia artist. I write electroacoustic and multimedia works that oscillate and are at home in a concert hall as well as a dance club. I do this because I believe that music should move people, not just emotionally, but physically. Three sentences, who, what, and why. Doesn't answer all questions, but if I structured my artist statement around those three essential facets of what I do, I can write for days, you know, illuminating those points. And so normally we're fine on the who, you're like, I know who I am, the problem is writing about it, right? I can kind of describe what I do, and we'll look at some categories of that in a second. And the one we really get hung up on, I think, is the why. So my first approach to answering the why, and this is the one thing that separates you from lots of other people, and that I could take your who and your what and erase your name and put Craig's name on it, and I could probably sell it, you know? But when I get to the why you do something, this is your value judgment. This is the moral underpinning of what you do, and it is the one thing that is most powerful in setting you apart from somebody else. And it's the one we trip up on. Why do we write music? Well, because I love it. And it was like, you know, we don't care about love. Or, you know, because I, you know, as a child, I was deeply moved, and we were like, we don't care about your childhood. And plus, we all love music, and we all had a childhood. You know, so you're not special, is what I'm saying. You're not a beautiful, unique snowflake. And so what I do here is I say, if you can flip this on its head, you know, so you go one, two, then three, and I try to answer it the other way, instead of saying, why do I do this? I do it because. I would say, because I believe that music should move people, not just emotionally, but physically, I write electroacoustic and multimedia works that are equally at home in the concert halls and dance club. My name is Noah, I'm a composer and multimedia artist. You see how that works? Like, it's like a palindromic sort of artist statement. But what I'm saying is, answer the why first, and uniquely set yourself up. I was like thinking, I'm gonna make a t-shirt that says cut to the bang, because I was like, that's the thing right there, is that if you just open up and say, look, because this is what I believe about music and why I make it, these are the things I do, this is who I am, that is a much more personal and gripping statement for someone to read than to start in with a whole list of your influences in history. You know, that's my opinion, of course, but this is exercise number one for you if you're struggling with writing about yourself. As I say, answer these three questions, and maybe start with your beliefs first, and then defend them with facts. Questions about that? One exercise. Okay, one down. The overall picture, this is slippery. The overall picture that I try to remind people is that your resume and your artist statement, right? And then your work samples. I mean, this is your application in a nutshell, these three parts. This is the past. This is the present. That totally says present, I promise. Or, you know, as I kind of, if I hearts on sleeves, I say the passion, because it's really about your vision and your voice in there. In the work sample, as Craig said, the all-important proof. And I think when you get past that 95% of like excellent music, and you're really splitting hairs and they're trying to figure out, yeah, do you have great, you know, are you a brilliant composer, or do you just know brilliant performers? And they're looking at all the other facets. And I think that if you can put these three things together so that there's a trajectory here or a through line that strengthens your work samples, you know, with the past work you've done and the sort of statement of who you are and what drives your work, it justifies what they're listening to. It gives them light or illuminates those sounds that they're hearing. So just as an overall structure, when you're done with all of this, and you're mopping your brow and you lay it out, and you're looking at it as a sort of like through thread, you know, does it have this sort of satisfying, overarching narrative that describes all these three different aspects of the work? Okay, five facets. This is an exercise, exercise number two, in generating content or words, or I think of them as palettes to work from. As you're saying, what do I talk about? Do I talk about my childhood? We already said no. Do I talk about my teachers? Maybe. So I came up with these five areas that sort of, again, stop worrying about it and just start generating material. I also spent a lot of time drawing this right here, because it's a five-faceted shape, and I was very proud, so I'm just pointing it out. Number one is objective information, which is to say just the facts. I don't want any adjectives, I don't want any, you know, subjective information. I just want you to factually describe what kind of instruments, what genres does it fall into, what are the venues that it is. Is it considered, you know, what are the schools of teachers or threads, you know, heritage that your music comes from? Literal facts about the work. They don't have to be sentences, I just suggest lists. And so this would be, you know, put on your white scientist coat, you know, and step back from your music and look at it like Sherlock Holmes and observe and list what you see. So very much an objective approach to generating things. Second, and this is probably where we would excel, would be, or first comes to mind, but influence or inspiration. So this is where you could say, my work is inspired by a whole wide range of interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary aspects. You know, I take from the literary arts, or I look at dance, or I'm really into Downton Abbey, and everything I write is about, you know, the dowager. It's just all dowager music. Is it the dowager or the dowagess? I can't remember. Sorry, we're in this room, and it's overtaking. But influences inspiration can be musical, extra musical, anything and everything that you draw, sort of catalyst energy from that inspires your work. And again, that doesn't have to be full sentences, but I think you can just start. I mean, do you think you could get 10 off the top of your head? I feel like we can probably do that. So there's five facets, and if you can do 10 for each, you have 50 different bits of really specific information in five different categories. A lot of material to work with. The third one, this is the weird one. There's always gotta be an oddball, right? And this one, even though I made this up, is to attempt to describe your work or what you do with all five of your senses, right? So put on your synesthesia hat here. Some of them will come easy for musicians, but we talk about how something is smooth, right? Or the textures are coarse. Those are tactile descriptors, right? Or that the, something is rich or pungent sounds, like you're using your nose and your mouth to describe audio. That's what I'm talking about. So in a way, this gives us some really colorful and creative language to nail down and create something memorable in writing. Because this other thing, if you've done like marketing or copy for things and you're trying to create sticky language, and you're looking at the types of words and phrases that you see and hear every day that stick in your head, like cut to the bam, you're like, why is that? Why does that stick in my mind? Or if I use, what is the problem with cliches? Why do we not like them in artist statements? Because they've been wrung dry of their specificity, and their entire definition is wrapped up in a stereotype, right? A not a unique experience, it's not detailed. This is the complete opposite of it, because you will come out with the weirdest ways of describing your music. And again, you might not be like, my music tastes like damp wood on a summer morning in Vermont. But maybe, does anybody's music sound But I don't know, I feel very strongly that certain instruments, certain combinations and ensembles take on, you know, sights, sounds, flavors, smells, things like that, you know. Good old bassoon, moldy, mossy log in the New England woods, right? It's like, so that's the weird one you could work with. Number four is space or place, as I say. And what we're looking at here is either physical, you know, where your work lives. Is it for small spaces or large spaces? Is it for digital venues or physical venues? The other aspect of it would be a philosophical or rhetorical space. So is it, does it fall on a political spectrum? You know, it's very political or it's totally apolitical? Or is it secular or is it religious? You know, and you can place yourself in there. So in my example, when I say between the concert hall and the dance club, what I'm doing is I'm saying, see these two points? These are my home bases and I'm everything in between it. And that is a space. It's a hypothetical space. But it makes you question, and I can then talk about those in detail. So I have a paragraph that's just talking about types of work that can belong in each, or works that belong in both, or somewhere in between where they don't fit. But that's how I begin that. And I came to it by talking and thinking about the spaces and the places, both real and philosophical. And then the last one.
You're not talking about necessarily a particular piece, but just your music, where it could, you know, like a piece could come out of the amphitheater in Utah mountains or something like that.
Yeah, so the way I would approach it, I would take your catalog, whatever you have, your resume or list of works, maybe the highlighted works, the your best works, and then I would start writing down where they exist. I mean, as a digital, you're doing a lot of digital work, that's a really important thing to me, that there are pieces that live, you know, on the internet. And they are, that's where they're supposed to be viewed, is on a little tiny screen for somebody. But they are not meant to be viewed in this setting. They're not meant to be viewed in the presence of other people, necessarily. So those are, you can take one piece and say, where does this belong? Belongs in an opera hall. It belongs with production and lighting. It belongs with like sort of a grand venue for a grand narrative, those sorts of things. But you can go piece by piece, and I think you'll find patterns. My most recent works, two last pieces that I did were for ping pong table. You know, one was we built a giant steel ping pong table that's in the Union Depot, and the other was a ping pong table that was all wired up with sensors and computer processing and stuff like that. And so that's a pattern, and the pattern, the place that it holds in my current work is audience interaction, you know, permeability, accessibility, play, aleatoric stuff. But those are things I write specifically about ping pong generated music. You see what I'm saying there? So you can do it iteratively, like piece by piece, and those places and spaces will sort of coagulate by themselves for you, hopefully. Or have somebody else do it. That's even better. You really want an objective view, hand it to someone else and be like, categorize this for me, will you please? Thank you. That'd be just fine. Did that, was it? good for now?
I think so.
Okay. Like I said, if I get through it all, then we'll have more time for questions at the end of any way, shape, and form. And then the last one is, as I said already, believe in something, have an opinion, have a moral compass, have a set of values that drive your work. This is the thing that will differentiate you the most, that will really make you human. And I think one of the worst things, the hardest things to do is to, you know, say, this is what I believe, and this is what makes me write music. Because that's a scary thing to say to a random panel of strangers you've never met. So I just try to remind people that, I think the fear of putting your opinion out there is that it will be rejected and you will fail at that. But they don't award grants for failure, they award grants for success. And I think it's the assumption that if you believe it and the work samples support it, then they are awarding you for success of having already justified those beliefs. But again, it's that, I think in the application, I don't know if the question prompts are in there, but some of them that say, you know, what is your vision of music in the future? Or where do you see yourself in the context of contemporary music? You know, what came before you and how are you contributing to that? You can talk in a very, you know, academic, historical context about that. But my guess is that history is not what drives that. History is something you're a part of, but your drive and your vision is somewhere else. And it's my feeling that it's in this belief right here. So that's a hard one, but you can say a lot of things like you believe. I believe that it is inhumane and cruel for people to sit and listen to music like this and not be allowed to move. Like that's it. Hurts my body, you know. I mean, come on, we're composers, you know, and you're like listening to a Tchaikovsky symphony and you're not allowed to, like, you know, or Verdi Requiem. It's like one of the first four on the floors ever, the big bass drum, and you just have to be like, there's like a single tear rolling down your head, sort of like stand up and shout. Like, that's not right to me. But that's my opinion, because we can fight about this all the, you know, all the articles about, like, oh, should people be allowed to tweet in a concert hall, and we can duke that out, you know. There's a whole spectrum there, but that's something that is a strong underpinning of me and my artist statement, and I own it, you know, because I think that's says it definitely separates me in a binary form of, like, the movers and the non-movers. Shut up, don't clap before movements, and maybe just a little bit. If it's in like check six or something. Okay, let's move on. I'm almost done. Here's the other thing that, so slippery today. Who cares, and oops, why now? This is from a kind of a general grant writing standpoint that I talk about a lot, but if you can answer these two things, you achieve a sense of relevancy. Which is to say, knowing who your audience is or who it connects to or how it matters, and saying something about you are now and you are of this time and this is why it is important. That is saying, who cares about this and why is now the time for it? The zeitgeist, right? It's kind of like that. And so when we talk about relevancy, if you've ever reviewed a grant where they're like, I want to release a CD, and you're like, why? Like, because I finished writing the music, and now's the time. Give me $5,000 to make a CD. I'm like, make it next year after you save $5,000. Like, I don't see relevancy there. I just see wants. But you haven't told me, you know, who cares about this physical item, and why now is the time to care about it versus 12 months from now. You see what I'm saying? Okay, so that's my little relevancy speech. How are we on time? Yeah, I have 1 minute to do all of this. Okay, here's the structure. This is my old Oxford method, which I do believe I learned way back in high school, and you might have a different name for it. But it's basically this, which is, tell them what you're going to say. Say it. Tell them what you said. Tell, say, set. And the bulk of it in the opening is the cut to the band sort of thing. And if you've taken any journalism classes, this is like journalism 101, right? There's this thing called the inverted triangle. And if this rectangle I drew here is a newspaper column, they teach you that the most important information goes at the top. And as you move down the article, you get smaller details that are less important to understand what's going on, which is why when you get to the bottom of the column and it says, jump to page, 7G for the rest of your story, you're just like, yeah, maybe I'll go to the crossword. Because you got enough of what you needed and you don't feel like you need any more details. This is me saying, cut to the chase. You have to lead with a strong statement, whether it's in music or in words, that says, look, this is what I'm all about. This is what I'm gonna talk to you about. I'm gonna talk to you about electroacoustic, multimedia visual works that exist in concert halls and dance venues, and they're meant to inspire people emotionally and move them physically. I've got six things to cover in the next two pages, no problem. Four sentences each, that's probably like 550 words, maybe-ish. So, but we can leave there, and then I cite good old Ira Glass too often, but if I were to comprise or compress everything he does, or his whole like philosophy about story writing, I think it is this, I think he said this, is that basically good storytelling is when you take a human and you subject them to something, and when they come out the other side, they are fundamentally changed. Done. I think you could apply that to everything he's ever done, and stuff, and it would be true. And so when I think about that in this instance, then I take my triangle and I turn it upside down. And what we have up here is, this is who I am and what I'm gonna talk about. And then in the middle, we start listing off details, getting nitpicky. But as we come out the other side of it, those details begin to synthesize into something so that when we tell them again what we said at the bottom, we have changed their perspective to the point where what we said at the top, they're like, maybe, I don't know how I feel about that. But when you say it again at the bottom, they're like, yes, I agree. I can see your point of view here. But that is to say, start strong, with this statement, and then build through detail work and then transform to the end where it's like, tell what you're gonna say, say the things, tell them what you said. That's my old Oxford method of essay writing, as I call it. And then my last little bit is pets and pits, which are my pet peeves and my pitfalls and things like that, stuff that I see a lot of. But I just want to list out some of these and then we'll be in Q&A. So one of them would be passive language. Always avoid passive language, if I do this, I could, or I hope, or I wish. I hate the word hope. Hope is a good thing, but it's a terrible word in essay form because it doesn't convince of any doing. It says, I hope this happens, but I can't guarantee I can do this with $25,000. So it's just very much, it's easier to take out the qualifiers instead of saying, if then, you can say with will. One's passive, one's active. And the active one communicates more confidence. It's also a lot easier to read. If you've ever read essays where there's a lot of backpedaling, clauses and parenthetical phrases crammed in there where they're like, I believe this. But in certain situations, it might be different because I can understand it and you're just like, shut up. Like, don't do that to yourself. You're second guessing yourself in front of me and don't like it. So passive versus active language. The qualifiers, I said, who is the, I'm trying to remember her name, Rachel Whitebread, I think? She's the artist that is famous for casting the inside of a house. She took a house and she cast, basically made a mold of the inside and then ripped down the house. And so literally what you're looking at is a structure built out of the empty space of a building. And so qualifiers are that way, where if you had to describe this phone by describing everything this phone was not, it would take a very long time, right? You're sort of like, Proust is very specific and pointed, but he is extremely verbose. be like, why couldn't you just tell me about the cookie instead of telling me about everything around the cookie? So those sorts of things are qualifiers, where rather than just saying the concise, concrete thing, you're trying to build, like, I'm not this, I'm not that, I'm not this. And I'm like, well, what are you? Just tell me what you are first. Which is not to say there isn't a place, but just be wary of them. Okay, probably my one of my least favorites is the long windup. And this is, I say, very common in composers, musicians, dancers, some writers, literary writers, but not script writers or screenwriters. They don't have this problem at all. But it's the idea of that organic process of where you introduce something and you say, okay, I'm going to start doing this. Here's a theme. And now I'm going to do a variation on the theme. Mm-hmm. And now I'm going to do this little progression. Mm-hmm. Now we're going to get over here, and about two-thirds of the way through, and then our little, what's that thing called, the denouement, and forgot his name, but you know, you're just like, bam, and now revelation happens. And revelation happens in your artist statement halfway down on page 2, and they have this thing to read through. Mm-hmm. They're not looking for a unique artistic narrative unfolding of your beautiful statement so that they can dig out a golden nugget from like 600 words in, okay? And I think that normally what I do when I find those sorts of statements, the most effective way thing to do with that is if you have written in that way where it's this unfolding, unfolding, and then you get to the point, I just circle it, I cut it out, and I put it at the top. And then I say, start over from here. Explain it the other way. So that's the long windup. It just makes it hard to really grasp what we're talking about if you're hiding information from your reader so that you can have a big reveal. Don't hide things from them. They usually don't like it. At least not when they have that thing together. And then, let's see, I'm wondering if I forgot any. Otherwise, that might be, I have my cheat sheet here. Nope, I think that's it. Oh, issue superfluous obfuscation, which is avoid unnecessary, complicated things. It's a funny phrase because it's like, it is itself that thing. Which is to say that clear, concise, and concrete, write it that way first, but don't pretty up the language with a bunch of adjectives and, you know, superlatives and all this stuff to make it look fancy and frilly, because the first thing I would do is I go through and I rip out all the passive language and I rip out all of the fluffy stuff and I see what's left, and I usually just find a bunch of generic things that I could assign to you or you or you or you, and it doesn't matter. And so that's why I say start being very direct and very crisp and clear about you, those five facets, pull from there, and then from there you can, you know, sort of carve out the beautiful detail work in later drafts. From a review standpoint, I think this is it. Work samples, this is my shiny, shiny, shiny. Context, 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 and curate, curate, curate. Only a game, consider where the works, how they relate to each other, at what point in your work sample. You know, it's to say you have multiple angles you can do, like an excerpt in the whole work that's context driven, and curate, which is to say, you know, looking at the body of, oh, there's a drawing of some mountains. Money is the answer, Q&A. I will say one of the other things I'll echo from what Craig said about reviewing them, that I think we as composers and musicians understand well, is not just have somebody else review it and read it to themselves, but have somebody else read it out loud to you. Because words that come out of your brain and through your eyeballs and into your fingers act a certain way. Those words with somebody else silently with a pen act a certain way, but when you have that person read your words and they're not coming in your eyes, they're coming in your ear, different things happen in your brain. And you'll catch them stumbling over phrases where the writing is bad or clunky, or they will read something they can't understand, and you'll hear it, but you won't see it, and they won't see it, or hear it, but you'll hear it. See what I'm saying? It's just like an easy way to help people edit that's different, a different experience. So, yeah. Okay, I think that's it.
That's great.
Amazing.
That was nice.
No, it's so important because I, you know, my sense is that more often than not, the panelists are going to read your material before they ever listen to the work samples. So the introduction to who you are as a composer is going to come through that artist statement. And if you can really engage them and inspire them and just make them, you know, just enchant them so they can't wait to listen to your music, I mean, that's kind of the perfect world.
That's a good question because in the musician one,
sure,
first round, all they hear is music, and it's not until you make it to the second round that they see your artist statement in your resume. I was going to ask that question actually about that. Do they get all the resume, the artist statement, work samples all at once?
No. We use three panelists. They're always from outside of the state of Minnesota, and traditionally we try to pick panelists that mirror the applicant pool. And you can't do it obviously verbatim, but traditionally we have a chunk of applicants who fall into the jazz improv category. We have a chunk of electronic electroacoustic composers, and then we have a chunk of sort of traditional Western classical concert music composers. So we usually try to find, you know, panelists that mirror those three areas. They all get panel books, and they've got about 6 weeks between when they get the panel books and when we bring the panelists here to really read through all this information. And they are responsible for reading every single application. And then we take the work samples and we divide them into three groups. And each panelist gets a third of the work samples. And they're responsible for listening to their third of the work samples. All right, and really familiarizing themselves with those. And then at the end of those 6 weeks, or at some point in the process, we bring them here, all three panelists, for a very long weekend of listening and talking. And whatever panelists have my work sample is responsible for sort of leading the discussion, introducing my application, leading the discussion. And then we expect them to be able to say, so the first work sample is really exciting. I really think the second work sample is better. Let's listen to that. And they might say, okay, it's a 30-minute piece. Let's listen to the first few minutes, and then it really doesn't change much. But at 15-minute interval, something amazing happens, so let's fast forward to that, you know, that kind of thing. So they don't get to listen to all the music, all three of them, until they're here. So the other, and we'll open it up for questions, the other thing I always recommend to people is volunteer to be on a panel. If you really want to, you know, sort of see exactly what works and what doesn't on applications. And MRAC, the Metropolitan Regional Arts Council, those folks run amazing programs and amazing panels. And, you know, it's some work, it's some effort to read through this stuff, but boy, I'll tell you, it's an amazing education in how to write a grant. You will instantly see what grabs you as a panelist, among the proposals you're reading and what ones don't. You know, so the State Arts Board's always looking for panelists, MRAC, Compass, you know, there's just a number of things out there. It's time well spent. So other questions? Yeah.
For the scores that are included in the application, do you want just one copy of each score?
Yep, just one copy of the scores. Yep. We need two identical copies of your audio or video, whatever. But yeah, just one score. Yeah.
Is there a point at which a person ceases being a mid-career composer?
We should say at least mid-career. They want you to be at least mid-career. You can be beyond mid-career. I don't know what that category would be called.
That would be me.
Late career, career or something, you know. So Dominic Argento could probably still apply for this. You know, kind of thing. But yeah, they just want to make sure that you are at least mid-career.
Do the works have to be performed in Minnesota?
No.
Okay.
Nope. Not at all. Yeah, Charlie?
If your works are a lot for other projects like film, video games, theater, would that kind of hurt your chances as samples?
Not really. I don't think so. I mean, it really is about who you are as a composer and how you define your career as a composer, you know, within the context of this. So as long as you're really clear in your artist statement about why you're submitting that, and the work you're doing, you know, I think that's absolutely valid. You
Oh, can we see copies of past or artist statements?
Yeah, you can. And if you want to come into the office sometime, we've got these
right
books.
In that book?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And you can
certainly look through them.
Yes.
When the panelists are split up into three groups, you're saying that the applications of the music be sent to the three different groups. What are the three different groups composed of?
We just take the full applicant pool. So if there are 75 applicants, each panelist gets 25 of the work samples, and we don't say you're the jazz. You're the jazz panelist, so we're only going to give you the jazz work samples. We just, you know, it's first come, first serve. We just divide them up into three groups and send them out.
Okay.
And you also said something interesting that after that point when they come back together, that maybe not all of the panelists will hear every work in totality. Like if I had this person's work, I would say, I listened to it. 5 minutes is when the big bang happens. Let's do that. So is that how it works? It's sort of a curtailed review at that point?
Maybe. Usually what happens is we absolutely promise that we will listen to the 4 minutes of that every applicant submits. All right. Usually a two-round process. We start and we go through the entire 100, whatever it is, and determine which composers we want to bring back for deeper listening. So we listen to the 4 minutes. If the panelist that had that work sample and is leading the discussion on that application says, you know, I think we should, you know, this is, I really want you to hear some of, you know, the second work sample to the third work sample. We'll take some time to do that and then decide whether or not to advance that composer to the next round. And usually about 20, 25 composers make it through to the second round. And then we have to pick four out of that. So.
Is there a quota on how many applicants can go through to round two, or is it just based on the will of the panel?
It's really it's up to the panelists to decide how many they want to advance.
This is helpful because I'm curious because I was formulating in my mind a 4-minute medley. And then having just two of those pieces is my next two. Like, mm-hmm. Well, you recommend, Nora recommended just three pieces in the medley.
I think I said that. I think any more than that, and it just gets a little confusing for the panelists.
Okay. And is it in the second round where they would listen to the entire medley of the pieces?
If in the case of a medley, if one of the panelists says, I really loved, you know, the second, you know, snippet or, you know, mm-hmm. excerpt or whatever, let's, can we hear more of that?
Mm-hmm.
That happens a fair amount.
Okay.
So then we would take the time to do that.
Okay, so I should include in the medley the excerpts from the next two pieces for sure.
I really think that's best.
Yeah. I have a question. You at the very last, you said shiny context and curate, and you're doing stuff, and then you started to say that when curate and the machine went sideways, and I didn't hear what else you said.
That was my slide. So I wasn't going to deal with work samples as much because Craig had addressed those. But when I do talk about work samples and how to select them, this is a very stress point for us where, you think of all the things you do and your question was, well, I was great at jazz and kind of retired a bit and now I'm great at film. So is my great jazz music irrelevant? Shrugs. So that's why when I say, shiny is basically if you weren't mid-career when you were doing jazz, you were emerging. And so even though they're good, they're not sparklingly great according to what you do now. Mm-hmm. I would question whether they are relevant because you're not trying to educate them on your history. You're just trying to show them magnificent work samples. So that's looking at how good is the work sample. The context portion is then, you know, that 4-minute intro, you know, what do you follow that with? It's like if you have to go on after Prince. It's like, oh gosh, you know? It's like lead with Prince and then Jimi Hendrix. You know, but is it that movement? It's like if you've ever made a playlist or a mixtape, that's what we struggle with. It's like what feels amazing and transformative and changing it enough that captures them, that says, oh, I love that, and like, oh, this is an interesting side dish to serve after, you know, a souffle. I think of it that way. That's the context. And then curating it is, if you have a lot of work, laying it all out and reorganizing it. So I don't know how you organize your portfolios, but we tend to go chamber music, orchestral music, choral music, solo works, small chamber pieces, the string quartet, you know, all these ensemble things. But maybe if you recurated it and you laid them on a table and said, I'm going to do things that are biographical, and they create new categories, you're recurating your work, not according to genre or ensemble, but according to topical influences. Maybe you say, I'm going to take everything based on a text and put it over here. Now what does your collection look like? So there's a lot of ways you can cut your body of works into new categories through recurating it that can sort of illuminate patterns where you say, okay, here's my A game, and if I recategorize this A game, what's the picture I want to piece together? So those three facets of your work sample, I think, the analysis of it can give you some interesting combinations that maybe you wouldn't have gone to immediately.
And my question again, after 30 years, yes, I had quite a bit of things going for that, but I don't have the samples as much as I do for the concert and the film stuff right now.
Sure.
So if I were to give you the highlights of what I have in the work sample, it would be skewed to what things were before and not necessarily reflective of where I'm headed.
Yeah.
And that was the question.
Okay.
But I think you've answered it as well, of what you're looking for, and I appreciate that.
Yeah. And I'm not a panelist, so I have been a panelist for lots of things, and that's where my knowledge comes from, and also working with artists and looking at their work samples. And this is the best sort of 3 points, say, I think these are the core elements that if you can look at your work through these lenses, mm-hmm. will lead you to know what your best work is, mm-hmm. not me telling you what your best work is.
And you'll also say that one of the work samples has to be something written in the last 3 years.
Right.
So
yeah.
Yeah. I have a quick question. You know, to that point, like my work is very connected to a visual context, you know, and would they look at a YouTube as a sample, or can you somehow connect it because it would be more effectively, you know, curated through a visual context that's, you know, within the context of the space that it was actually created for?
My application for the year that I received one in 2008, there was a excerpt of a acoustic chamber piece.
Mm-hmm.
There was a video file, so I put mine on a DVD. Because the second work sample was a digital video piece, so it was animation with electronic sound.
Okay.
No live performers, no score, it was fixed media.
Mm-hmm.
And the third piece was a studio recording that I'd written for dance.
Mm-hmm.
And because I felt there was an importance of movement in forming the musical choices, I submitted a second video, also no score, because it was a studio recording, that was of the dance performance with my music. And what I actually did, and this is, I think, fair, is rather than use the audio recorded from a stationary camera, which sounds terrible, I ripped out the audio and I put in the studio recording. So the audio quality was studio perfect, and then it had the visuals of the dance because it was integral to that piece. So you can see the multimedia where I moved. I said, look, I can do chamber, and I can do digital, and I can do multimedia, and the visual component's important. They gave me one, so.
We did a lot of video.
And do they have, do the panelists have an internet connection that they're, when they're
It all would have to be submitted either on a DVD,
on a DVD.
Or,
So it is,
So it wouldn't be a link, it would be an actual video file.
I'm learning that there's ways to download your YouTube thing. I think the handwriting was one program.
Well, my sister's in tech. He did. I did some. I'm a dancer, so I think he used Mozilla Firefox and got footage of me off of YouTube and sent it to me as a video file. And then I just, you know, downloaded it to my hard drive. And you're able to use your own editing software or someone else's editing software.
CJ.
You know, I don't mean to put Peter on the spot, but Peter, three or four years ago, you won the McKnight.
Yes.
And your work samples were stunning.
highly choreographed percussion, and I probably not going to describe them well. But he put some money into really creating, you know, just work samples that you have to watch, you know, when they're on the screen. You cannot not watch them. And it paid off. I mean, it just immediately grabs the attention of the panelists and says, wow, this is somebody who's really serious. You know, and I'm convinced that that's, you know, that really catapulted you to the top of the heap pretty quickly. Dancers have amazing work samples and really put in a lot of time and a lot of money, I think, you know, into creating really, really solid work samples too. So composers have it maybe a little easier because we just do a DVD or something, a CD. But, you know, it pays off to put some time and effort into them. Really present yourself as professionally as you can. The million-dollar question is MIDI files, right? You know, how can I submit MIDI files? And that's another one where there's no million-dollar answer. Again, it's really up to you. And we get a lot of them. And some panelists are fine with them. I've seen other panelists just go, you know, I can't listen to these. You know, and there are, nowadays, like, I use Finale. The Garratan samples are really pretty good if you work with them, and, you know, for instrumental sounds. They can do a pretty good job of replicating the sound. Choral and vocal are horrible, so I would never submit those. But my answer always is that all three of the panelists are going to be either composers, conductors, or performers, and they're going to be used to looking at scores and being able to read the score. So if your MIDI file just really, you don't think, does a good job at all or even hurts you, I wouldn't send it at all. I would just send the score and trust that they're going to be able to look at it and hear it and not be biased by a MIDI recording. So thanks for coming out tonight. Again, huge thanks to Noah. And, so wonderful. And check out Springboard if you're not familiar with all their programs. They're amazing. And my contact information is on the bottom of the guidelines. And feel free to call, email, whatever. And we're more than happy to help. And yeah, if you want to come in sometime to look through the books, that's doable too. So excellent. Thank you, folks. Yeah. Safe travel.
Thank you.